Hi, Michael from the Red Chair Diaries, Bedford, Nova Scotia, and I will continue with some of my Star Trek books. I know that some people would find this incredibly boring, but I think I have a small coterie of viewers that are enjoying it. And I identify the titles well, don't I? I mean, like the subject line. So if you don't like it, you don't see it, and if you like that sort of thing, you can watch it. I'll show you a few oddball things now. Well, I have about four other things I want to show you before I show you some more books. Besides my hair, you know, I do not wear a toupee. This is why it looks odd. It looks my hair always looks like a wig if I don't get a cut. Anyway, these are some coffee mugs I picked up at the conventions. I've been to many conventions. I've probably been to three or four, maybe. I think you can see that. And it's one of those trick mugs, you know, that if you... they disappear. The figures basically partially disappear if you heat it up with hot water or coffee, whatever the case may be. So I always found those amusing. I mean, you can see where things have worn out. I also have one of the same technology, which you can get in a lot of different coffee mugs, for the stealth bomber. And that one I think was a present, and you know, I mean, you see it before you put the hot coffee in, and then the stealth bomber disappears. I always thought that was kind of cute. And this one is a Star Trek The Next Generation, which is the most popular series anyway. And that's Captain Picard. It's hard to see him right there. But you can see the jumpsuit sort of thing from the first year, I guess. That's what that is. And another hint is his signature on the back. I showed you this picture before, didn't I? No, this one here, that really is an autographed photo of Patrick Stewart, and I used to tell people he was related to me just to get them going. And I bought that at a convention. You know, sometimes these things are sold for charity, but it was at some kind of little auction or something. I think I paid $12 for it, and I thought that was okay. This is one of two transporter badges I have. I don't think I ever bought them. I think people gave them to me. I have two that are basically the same, and these are not the ones who make any sound. But kind of not transporter, you know, a communicator badge. But I always thought they were kind of nice. And this is what I wear. I used to wear to work as my Halloween costume. That I would wear a sweater and this, well, pants and shoes as well. It wasn't that liberal a place. Now this hair, I don't know if you had it in Australia or England or whatever, if there was a version of it, because our theaters were called Famous Players in those days. And but I think they were partially owned by Paramount, so you might very well have had a version of this down in the States with a different logo at the top there. This is what I bought my pop in when Generations came out in November 94. Well, that was quite the month for movies. Generations and Interview with the Vampire both came out then. And look at this. I mean, the character, remember, wasn't even in Generations. Unless it's supposed to be Worf, but I don't think it is. And look at the straw. I still have it. Look at that. Oh my God, I just broke part of it. Oh, isn't that funny? Okay, anyway. I think it was supposed to be the permanent straw. Oh my God. But look at it. I thought the whole idea of eating out of a Klingon's head was hysterical. I thought that was so funny. Just got back from town having our chicken wings. I'm having wine now, but our friend Gary, of course, had four beers. He's sitting there. I feel loaded just by sitting there. I'm driving, so I couldn't. Here's some of my paperbacks. I have dozens more. What is that? Star Trek Deep Space Nine. The Siege, the first original novel based on the hit television series. So this is called number two because the first one was novelization of the pilot. Interesting, eh? My Enemy, My Ally, back to an Star Trek novel of the first series universe. Gulliver's Fugitives. I didn't see this one either. The Next Generation, number 11. Now, an autographed copy of this book here. See, I don't even remember I've got these things. Star Trek Vulcan's Forge. I guess I really do like the Vulcan stories, best of all. The Tradition of Sarek and Spock's World. Yes, there's a signature in front, and this is from 1997. Anybody want to buy this? I've got it. Vulcan's Forge. Enemy Unseen. So this is the universe of the first movie, I guess. If you look at the clothes they've got on. Enemy Unseen. Star Trek The Next Generation, Fortune's Light. So this was number 15. A missing jewel may bring war to an entire world and death to Commander Riker. We could only hope. Anyway. Bobbin, come on up. Come on, jump up. Fortune's Light. Come on, jump up. Come on, stop bothering. Oh, yes, move the Klingon head before you, or you can't get up. Okay, come on, up you go. Now, this is one of the few novels, of course, that had Dr. Pulaski in it. She was brought in, they thought she was going to replace Gates McFadden, but the fans didn't care for that. A Call to Darkness. So that would be from 88, 89. Star Trek The Next Generation, Masks. This was another unauthorized Trekker's Guide to The Next Generation and Deep Space Nine. I read quite a bit of it, actually. So they can't even have a ship on the cover, right? And this, I had read this book when the first series was on in the 60s, and I never kept the books I had. But I remember reading this, and then a friend of mine bought me a copy at a used bookstore maybe 15 or 20 years ago. A Star Trek novel, Spock Must Die, by James Blish, and he was a noted science fiction author. He was a real science fiction author. And then I have a few hardcovers here left of novels. I might still have some more. I've got an awful lot of stuff. I mean, this one sounds like fun, doesn't it? The Vulcan Academy Murders. Science Fiction Book Club edition. This is a very good book. This is one that I probably bought on remainder. I don't think it's the Science Fiction Book Club. Star Trek, Spock's World, very good, very interesting. You know, I told you I like the Vulcan mythology, so I enjoyed this book. I remember that. Yesterday's Sun. I meant to read this because this is like a follow-up to the TV episode where, you know, Vulcan, Spock is in the Ice Age. They all had to pick a period in time or whatever when the world was exploding, where the library was. And then, you know, he had sex with Marriott Hartley, and so then he's got a son. And then this is another one of the major books that was written to tie things together, Star Trek The Next Generation Reunion. Never got to this one. In the grand tradition of Spock's world, The Lost Years and Prime Directive, each a blockbuster New York Times bestseller, they have the eagerly awaited first Star Trek The Next Generation hardcover reunion, a novel of mystery, intrigue, and perilous adventure. And that's November 91. I keep most of them in pretty good condition, don't I? Look at that. 20 years ago. I was only 17. Anyway, I think that's about it for now. That's probably enough. And don't eat anything bigger than your head. Don't forget to enter my contest next week.